You're saying this infection comes from the MMR vaccination?
That is the hypothesis that we're testing.
Dr. Wakefield's got some theories, but absolutely no findings.
In its retraction, The Lancet now agrees, saying the claims in the original paper have been proven to be false.
There might be a conflict of interest there if Wakefield was selling an alternative vaccine, right?
The allegations against me and against my colleagues are both unfounded and unjust.
1996, a small office somewhere in the United Kingdom. Two people scheduled a meeting. An intangible aura of tension saturated the air. Both men have anticipated this day for a long time. The reason for the meeting? To launch one of the biggest schemes in modern medicine. With a single handshake, these men will set off a chain reaction that would irreversibly damage an entire field of medicine. While it would take decades until the nature of the meeting was uncovered, we continue to experience consequences, even in the present day. This is the story of one of the biggest scandals in modern medicine. But let's take a step back for a moment. In science, we try to recognize and make sense of patterns. These patterns, in turn, allow us to formulate hypotheses and help us to explain some aspects of the world. But not every pattern is connected. These two lines nearly align perfectly. But one explains the number of high school graduates and the other pizza consumption. We as scientists need to identify meaningful patterns. Here's another graph. This is the number of diagnosed autism spectrum disorder cases from 1988 to 2001 in the UK. What could explain this dramatic increase? This question was raised by one man in the UK, Andrew Wakefield. Andrew Wakefield was born in 1956 in Eton, Berkshire, England. From a young age, Wakefield already showed an interest to become a doctor, so he chose to follow his parents' footsteps and pursue a career in medicine at St. Mary's Hospital Medical School in London. After graduation, he specialized in gastrointestinal surgery, and he slowly became interested in academic research. So he briefly went to Toronto, Canada, and moved back to the UK to join the Royal Free Hospital in London. In the first years of his medical career, Wakefield studied Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease is a disorder where patients experience persistent inflammation in their guts. While numerous factors impact the risk of developing Crohn's disease, it is often hard to pinpoint why the disease breaks out in a specific person. Wakefield stood at the forefront of this research, and he had an idea. Using tissue samples from 15 patients, Wakefield claimed to have found measles virus traces in the majority of the cases. Based on his findings, he proposed that the measles virus may be the cause of Crohn's disease. This was later debunked by other research groups, who found no connection between the measles virus and Crohn's disease. So Wakefield shifted his focus to another research field. This is where the second character of today's story comes into play, John Walker Smith. Walker Smith was a renowned pediatric gastroenterologist at the University of London. Wakefield and Walker Smith decided to work together to find out if chronic gut inflammation impacts the development of children. They recruited 12 children for a small study, all of whom experienced abdominal pain. Not really remarkable. However, these 12 children allegedly experienced a sudden decline in their social behavior and speech abilities. So what causes deterioration? When Wakefield interviewed the parents, he found that the majority of parents attributed the regression of the child's abilities to the MMR vaccine. The MMR vaccine has been approved in the UK a few years prior and protects against measles, mumps, and rubella. Although possible side effects of the MMR vaccine have been studied, Wakefield theorized that the MMR vaccine could induce autism in children. According to Wakefield, child 1, 2, 6, 8, 9, and 11 showed signs of autism within 2 weeks after vaccination. Child 3, 4, 7, and 10 even within 2 days. The 12 children then visited the hospital and underwent a series of tests. Wakefield collected samples from the children's intestines, and he verified chronic inflammation in all cases. It seemed like Wakefield had just made a major discovery. Although the study mainly centered around a possible connection between the MMR vaccine and gut inflammation, Wakefield emphasized that the 12 children exhibited a notable pattern of normal behavior followed by a loss of acquired skills. After they concluded the tests, Wakefield and Walker Smith quickly summarized the results and published them in 1998. The article was labeled an early report, stating that it didn't provide an association between the MMR vaccine and the symptoms described. Still, Wakefield was ready. He wanted to share his results with the world and organized a press conference. It was originally agreed that a panel of five doctors with different opinions would discuss Wakefield's findings. The five had rehearsed the press conference in advance and planned that they would recommend continued use of the MMR vaccine pending further research. But it all fell apart during the events. Wakefield questioned the safety of the MMR vaccine and instead called for the usage of single vaccines. It was weird that Wakefield adopted such strong positions, even though he had only conducted one small study. Surely there is nothing going on behind the scenes. And that's called foreshadowing, folks. Following the announcement, the majority of scientists were cautious and awaited additional evidence before drawing definite conclusions. But the media, oh boy, they couldn't get enough. It was a newspaper's dream. Innocent children exploited by the pharmaceutical industry profiting from the vaccine. The possible dangers of the MMR vaccine became the topic of discussion. Numerous news outlets interviewed parents who had witnessed a normally developing child regressing into autistic behavior soon after MMR vaccination. Wakefield was becoming one of the most renowned doctors in the UK and worldwide. Those who worked alongside him vividly recalled the extraordinary atmosphere that surrounded him and his work. Wakefield's team even talked about how they will win the Nobel Prize one day. But there was one problem. Wakefield needed to provide definite evidence that the MMR vaccine causes gut inflammation and autism. So he assembled a small team of doctors. Among them was John O'Leary. John O'Leary was an Irish pathologist and a strong believer that traces of the measles virus might cause chronic inflammation. In 2000, Wakefield and O'Leary presented research to a US congressional committee showing that 24 out of 25 autistic children tested had traces of the measles virus in their guts. Some media launched campaigns backing Wakefield, which ultimately exerted pressure on the safety and administration of the MMR vaccine. As a consequence, MMR vaccination numbers in children fell from 91.8% to 78.9%, much less than the 92% required for herd immunity. Measles and mumps cases across the UK started to rise. There were only a few hundred cases between 1996 and 1998, and suddenly there were thousands of cases. And Wakefield's findings soon became controversial. Within a year of Wakefield's publication, researchers at his home university conducted their own study. Investigating 498 autism spectrum disorder patients, they found no association between the timing of MMR vaccination and the occurrence of autism. Now, scientists all around the world tried to replicate Wakefield's results with much larger patient numbers. In 2002, one study in Denmark involving over 537,000 children found no association between the MMR vaccine and autism. A study in the US involving 624 patients came to the same conclusion. Other teams of researchers in the UK, Japan, US, and Denmark also found no evidence supporting Wakefield's results. And even in subsequent years, no link between MMR vaccines and autism spectrum disorder was found. This is weird. Wakefield allegedly observed the effects of MMR vaccination on gut inflammation and autism by studying only 12 children. Statistics tell us that studies with larger patient sizes generally should support Wakefield's hypothesis, offering greater confidence in the findings. Let's assume we conclude a study involving 20 patients and identify varying degrees of inflammation. On the x-axis, you can see the degree of inflammation, and on the y-axis, the relative number of patients. Some patients have no inflammation, others exhibit mild, moderate, or strong inflammation. If we only investigate 20 patients, we might see the right trend, but there is a high risk that a single patient with exceptionally strong inflammation skews the overall graph. If we now repeat the same study with 100 patients, our distribution might look similar. However, this time we would be much more resilient to the influence of outliers. This is also explained by this formula, but independent studies with higher sample sizes couldn't verify Wakefield's results. Was there something wrong? This is what Brian Deer tried to find out. Brian Deer was a journalist who had gained recognition for his efforts in uncovering fraudulent science. In the past, he has exposed scientists and pharmaceutical companies who had manipulated data regarding the safety of certain medications. Now he tried to find out how dangerous the MMR vaccine really is. He traveled to some of the parents involved in the clinical study and asked them about their experiences with Wakefield. In the beginning, these stories seemed quite straightforward. Concerned parents were worried about a child's behavior, came across Wakefield's trial, and decided to join the project. But when Deer started talking to the parents, something seemed off. Dear realized that the parents didn't randomly find Wakefield. In fact, most of the parents were connected. Very suspiciously connected. Some of the parents were clients of one law firm that hoped to bring a lawsuit against vaccine manufacturers. One of the major claims in Wakefield's study was that in 8 out of 12 cases, the parents or the children's doctors made the connection between the MMR vaccine and the onset of behavior problems. But given that at least some of the parents were part of a lawsuit against vaccine manufacturers, some of them were likely biased in their interviews. So this finding is pretty redundant. But then it even became weirder. When Deere dug a bit deeper, he found that the same law firm was also in contact with Wakefield. That's when the connection became clear. According to Deere, the law firm paid for Wakefield studies on the safety of the MMR vaccine, overall receiving over £435,000. In response to Deere's report, Wakefield stated that the funding was provided for another study, although others clearly found a conflict of interest. This was only the beginning though. After Deere's report came out, 10 out of the 13 authors of Wakefield's study retracted their names. Other collaborators, including Walker Smith and O'Leary, released statements that they were not aware of Wakefield's affiliations. Amidst these findings, Deere released an article describing an interview with one of the involved parents, the father of child 11. And it was unprecedented. According to him, the data clearly appeared to be distorted. He reported that his son exhibited behavior symptoms a month before he received the MMR vaccine. However, Wakefield's report would claim that he developed symptoms 2 months later, after his son received the vaccine. Other parents made similar statements. Child 4 and 8 showed developmental delays before the MMR vaccination, although Wakefield stated that all 12 children were previously normal. According to a panel investigation later, 3 of the 9 children who, according to Wakefield's study, were diagnosed with regressive autism didn't have a diagnosis. And child 6 and 7 were brothers and both exhibited gut inflammation before receiving the MMR vaccine. And that's not all. Some of the patient histories seem to have been further altered. Walker Smith wrote a letter to Wakefield and another doctor concerning child 1. It's difficult to associate a clear historical link with the MMR and the answer to autism. Although Ms. 1 does believe that child 1 had an illness 7 to 10 days after MMR, when he was pale, fever, delirious, but wasn't actually seen by a doctor. This report was later changed, the question marks were removed, allegedly by Wakefield, the time of onset set to 7 days and described as behavior symptoms of autism. Child 5 was reported to have symptoms months before the MMR vaccination, but the publication claimed that the symptoms arose after the vaccination. And this goes on and on. At this point, all hell went loose. In 2001, Wakefield resigned from his position. He then went on to co-found an autism center in Texas, US, but resigned in 2010. The General Medical Council opened its case alleging serious misconduct by Wakefield, Walker Smith, and a third author of the original study. It was ruled that Wakefield acted dishonestly and irresponsibly and showed callous disregard, but especially for another incident. According to the investigation, Wakefield performed unnecessary colon biopsies and lumbar punctures, both procedures that require hospitalization without ethical approval. Wakefield's publication was finally retracted and Wakefield and Walker Smith both lost their licenses. But Deere continued his work to find further motives for Wakefield's actions. And he found something interesting. An application for a patent filed by Wakefield. This patent describes, quote, "a combined vaccine therapeutic agent which isn't only most probably safer to administer to children and others by way of vaccination immunization, but which can also be used to treat inflammatory bowel disease and regressive behavioral disease." This vaccine patent was filed a couple of months before his original publication and before the press conference where he called for alternatives to the MMR vaccine. Yeah. And according to Deere, Wakefield already described the correlation between autism and vaccination in a grant application, even before launching a study. And that's scientifically impossible. So what happened then? To this day, Wakefield defends his work and accuses his critics of making unfounded and unjust allegations. After vanishing from the public eye, he resurfaced and became an anti-vaccine advocate in the US, where he's active to this date. Walker Smith, who worked with Wakefield, distanced himself. A few years later, Walker Smith could appeal the verdict of the commission and received his medical license back, although he has already retired in 2001. So how can we now explain the rise in autism spectrum disorder diagnosis? The most likely answer is less spectacular than the MMR vaccine. People are simply more aware. The DSM-3 established autism as its own separate diagnosis in 1980. And since then, people became more and more aware that autism spectrum disorder exists. While people might not have known autism spectrum disorder some decades ago, it is now more prominent than ever, even in popular culture. And that means that it's more tested and more diagnosed. The study conducted by Wakefield had a significant impact, leading to widespread skepticism and mistrust in vaccines. Unfortunately, this climate of doubt often impeded the open and constructive dialogue on the topic. Vaccines protect against often deadly diseases, so much so that we have already eradicated one of them. But vaccines, like any other drug, can have side effects, and in rare cases, these side effects can be serious. Hopefully, we will get to a place where medicine is not as much politicized, enabling an open and informed discussion. And I'm sure this will happen in the comment section.